Good morning and welcome to the programme. We hope you are well this morning. We are going to have a nice mixture of different things this morning. A few people have been texting in. Very, very important, as you heard Ollie and Mary say, to stay mentally and physically well. However you do that, please do as much as you can. Activity, whether it's exercises in the house, we heard Lynn yesterday talking about it, or going out for a good social distancing walk. Stay mentally and physically well. One way of doing that is listen to some music. And there's some great music being played this morning by Ollie and Mary. So we're going to have our own little Eurovision song contest this morning. As you heard yesterday, the Eurovision has officially now been cancelled. So we want people to text in. What's your favourite Eurovision song? Would it be something like this?
Such a long time looking out for you, but you're not here.
What you think, folks? Would it be something like this?
Don't close your heart to how you feel. Dream, and don't be afraid, the dream's not real. Close your eyes.
I can see people putting their arms up in the air now in the kitchen, dancing around.
Make believe this moment's here to stay.
Or would it be something like this?
Snowdrops and daffodils, butterflies.
So we're just giving you a flavour of it there. So we're going to have our own very Irish Eurovision song contest this morning. We want you to send us in, text us in, please. What is your favourite Irish Eurovision song? It may be a song that actually won the Eurovision. It doesn't have to be. So we'll go through a different list and we're going to play that song at the end of the programme. So just a taster there of What's Another Year by Johnny Logan, Hold Me Now by Johnny Logan, All Kinds of Everything by Dana. So Pat has texted in Waterloo. We're going to stick this morning. I wonder, okay, well, if people want to text in any Eurovision song, go on then, Pat. Fair play to you. We're a programme that responds to our listeners' needs and requests, and we will do that. Now, everybody is worried. That's the first thing you have to, I suppose, think about. Everybody is worried. None of us know what's going to happen. And I think, as Telma has just texted in, our regular listener, just edge forward every day. Don't be sad. Just get up every day and just say, I'm going to take one day at a time and edge forward every day with a positive attitude. That is so, so important. Marc, good morning.
Good morning, Damien. How are you?
I'm good, thank you. I know you're stopped on the side of the road on the way up to Dublin. Thank you very much for joining us this morning. You are Green Party TD. Again, any politicians that we have on during these times of crisis is not a political issue. It's basically for information. We're going to have David Cullinanae on later talking about another topic. But you are important this morning for us because you're spokesperson on social protection. A lot of people texting in, Marc, about social protection and about issues regarding social protection. Can I just ask you first, if people text in and want to know or have questions about their rights under the new situation we have now, what do they do? Who can they contact? Who can they get in touch? Just for basic information, firstly.
Well, a good first port to call, Damien, is that there's actually a very wide range of measures that are in place. And I have to give credit to the department who've had a very good response. But it can be difficult to find the right information for your own situation. I've brought all of that information together. I've made it available through my social media channels. So if people want to check out, in particular, my Facebook, I have a note posted there that runs through all the different situations that people might find themselves in, be it part-time work, be it that they've actually fallen ill themselves, be it if they've been laid off, I have a full range there of the different possibilities, and just click through options, click through links.
Okay.
That will bring you to the department website, which will have the relevant information.
Yeah, that's a very good thing. And as I say, this is not a political matter whatsoever. This is a public information exercise that we're doing, and we're dealing in facts on this radio station, as the other radio stations are doing as well. A couple of simple questions. You may or may not be able to answer that. One regarding social unemployment section. If you're diagnosed with COVID-19 and isolated at home or in a hospital, do you have to be available for work or seeking work? Also, if no, just, yeah, that one, okay?
No, Damien, and there's a special payment. There's an enhanced payment if you're diagnosed with COVID-19. So if you're certified for that, there's an enhanced payment of €305 per week, which is just above €100 extra on what you'd normally be entitled to. It does need to be certified, as in you will need to be tested, but you don't have to be seeking employment. No, the whole point of that payment is that people have the option to properly self-isolate. And that's the much more important thing at the moment, that people who are sick do self-isolate. Mm. Focus on their own health, focus on their recovery,
okay,
but also to limit the spread of COVID-19.
But the practical thing on this, Mark, for example, if somebody is self-isolating, don't you have to go and actually collect your payment or sign something in relevant papers? In other words, you can't obviously go to the social welfare office. Will the social welfare people working there receive documents from others if they've been given them by somebody else, by a relative, I wonder?
Well, Damien, they're not encouraging people to attend offices in person for obvious reasons.
I know,
to limit the spread. However, you can do it online. So if you have a public services card, you can go to mywelfare.ie and you can fill your details in there. Otherwise, there's a facility. If you don't have a public services card, you can print off a very much simplified one-page form. And that will include your bank details. It means that the payment that you'll receive will go straight into your bank account. Now, if anybody is in a position where they can't download and print that form, please contact me and I will be happy to post them out a form. We'll print off extra forms.
Okay.
And I'll be happy to post that form. It's a very simple one-page form. You can then free post it back to the Department of Social Protection and they'll process your payment from there. So no, people aren't being encouraged to attend the offices
yes.
in person. There is a facility for people to be paid directly into their bank account or by whatever means they prefer. So it's been very much streamlined. There will certainly be a waiting period because they're going to be inundated with requests. However, the department are working exceptionally hard. They really have slimmed down the process. They've really slimmed down the form. They've made it absolutely as easy as possible for people who find themselves in this situation to access at least a kind of enough, basically, to feed themselves during the period.
Yeah, and my understanding, and this is coming from Regina Doherty, and I was talking to people within that department this morning, and people may have had this perception before that social welfare are trying to catch you out, or they're trying to put barriers up. Any perception like that has completely changed. This is now completely...
We're in a different time, David.
We're in totally different times. And the staff have been told this. It's get out there, it's help people, it's get money to people's bank accounts, it's work this out, let's work through this. So this attitude is it's a can-do, helping attitude that is imbued now within the Department of Social Welfare. Would that be your feeling?
And I don't believe either, Damien, that people are going to abuse this process. I have a great sense of the country, of the nation, of our communities coming together. And I don't think anybody is going to make use of these payments who doesn't absolutely need them. There's going to be a huge burden placed on the public purse. We're going to crash into very difficult economic times on foot of this disease. I don't think anybody's going to abuse it. I have a great feeling in the communities as I get out and I talk to people, with social distancing, of course. But I have a great sense of everybody pulling together. And I think the department are honouring that as well. They're really slimming it down. They're making it as easy as possible for people to access the money that they're going to need over the next few weeks. So I encourage people, have a look at the department website, but that's difficult.
Can I ask you... Another question mark. A lady has texted in, Anne, saying that her 6 monthly cert regarding illness is due within 2 weeks. Obviously, she's concerned. She'd normally attend the QO practice in Lisdoogan. Like, this is a cert, obviously, that has got to do with the doctors, but also got to do with maybe social welfare and workplaces. So is your understanding, are workplaces working with the likes of social welfare quite closely, that if people have sick certs and things like that, that they'll work with them through this?
That is my understanding, Damien. But a lot of these things will come out in the wash. There's also a huge issue around people who are here working on short-term visas. And for example, a lot of those people are working in our healthcare system. There might be doctors and nurses from other countries, and they're not going to be able to renew their visas within the short time frame. But the government has been very flexible. To give them their due, they've been very flexible in their response to this situation. I would say to that woman, get in contact with your social welfare office or get in contact with me or one of your other representatives.
Yeah.
But I feel very sure that she's going to be well looked after.
And the important message is, and all politicians have access to information which other people may not have, is to contact your local politicians, contact your citizen information office, contact the council. People are there to help. There really is a can-do helping attitude out there, Marc. Are you feeling any kind of how would you describe the current situation? Like, because people are texting in and we're reflecting those in text, but we're also promoting happiness and well-being and all that sort of thing. Like, what's your feeling out there at present?
Look, Damien, the Taoiseach, I think, gave a very good address to the nation, where he struck the right note between optimism and our need to work together and that sense of reality. There is a surge coming. We shouldn't underestimate the importance of social distancing, the importance of washing our hands. These things that sound very simple, they sound almost silly, but those are going to have a huge effect over the next 2, 3, 4 weeks in terms of flattening the curve and making sure that the most vulnerable, the people who are going to need ICU, for example, in the coming weeks, that the capacity remains within our hospital system to give people the best treatment they possibly can do. So we have to be real about it. There is a huge challenge in front of us. Things are going to get worse before they get better. But as I said to you before, I have that huge sense of our nation and our community, our county, pulling together. I want to say a word of thanks to all of the frontline workers, be that hospital staff, be people who are working in the shops. Also, I want to say a huge word of thanks to people like yourself, and people like the News and Star, the Munster Express. It's really showing us in the quality of the public service broadcasting that we're getting and the public service media, it's showing us the importance that people get their information from the right places and from trusted sources. Now, we all probably knew in the first week when this outbreak was kind of coming home to roost for us, there was WhatsApp messages flying. There was all sorts of carry on social media. That's died down.
It has.
People have realised.
They have,
this is serious. We go to trusted sources. We put on our Damien Tiernans. We get our News and Star, our Munster Express. We support those things. Make sure that when we're communicating the messages with one another, that we're not doing dirt ban lum, go dirt ban lay. That we're passing on the proper information and getting people to trust the sources.
And the government, Marc, are going to have to reflect that and, I suppose, accept that, because there is a strong possibility that newspapers or certain radio stations around the country may fold because we're based on advertising. So if you're in any talks with any government ministers, I think, and this is not just from a local radio perspective, but our trusted sources and our contacts and the message we're putting out there is as important, in my opinion, to people in Waterford as is RTE. And as you know, I used to work for them.
Absolutely.
So, like, the advertising thing is just falling down through the hole at the minute. So we definitely need government support, and government needs to recognise that. And it's not just us, it's the Irish Times, it's all other different companies as well. So listen, keep up the good work yourself, Marc, and hope yourself and your family are well and safe, and we'll keep in touch, okay?
Thanks for the call, Damien. And I'd urge again, if anybody has any issues, if anybody wants clarification on anything, this is my job. I'm a trusted oil, I'm a messenger for the people. Get in contact with me, get in contact with my office, and we'll do everything that we can to help you out.
Okay, Marc O'Cathasaigh. Slongo Fold. Talk to you soon.
Thank
okay,
you,
take it easy. Bye-bye. People texting in, if anybody is texting in their questions, as you say, get in touch with Mark or get in touch with any of the politicians, in particular citizen advice, information, things like that. Hi, I work and my partner are due no childcare. We've a boat to reduce our hours. Is there anything we can apply for? We still have our bills to pay, but we are still both working at reduced hours. I can't answer that question. Any questions that come in that I don't know, I'm not going to pretend that I know, but I will advise you to get in touch with people that do know. So the likes of Mark, the likes of David Cullinanae, the likes of Jim Griffin, whether it be Thomas Phelan down in Dungarvan, any of the politicians certainly would point you in the right directions, but also in terms of the social welfare offices directly as well. Damien, I hope people in Waterford support local businesses, particularly when this is over. Damien, people can get their pensions paid into the bank. They'll get a double payment at some stage. Damien, what about Dustin? That was a great song. That was terrible. Damien, like me, half the country is out of work. When will we get social welfare from Ray? They're going to get as quick as possible, as far as I understand. Damien, the banks have agreed to defer mortgage payments. What's the story with vulture funds? Are people not going to be protected from them? And also rents. We're going to be talking to David Cullinanae about that in a few minutes. A lot of people texting in their ideas of the best songs, Eurovision songs. We're going to have more of that in a little while. Also, we're going to have the Feed the Heroes campaign. Kino Flaherty is coming on, and we're going to talking to Sister Anastasia about a new service, Dial a Prayer. Now, keep your texts and your comments coming in, 083 333 975. In a second now, I'm going to be talking to Keane O'Flaherty regarding the Feed the Heroes campaign, a really good campaign. Another mention of our Faith Lake House Hotel competition, afternoon tea and a spa treatment. We're giving a prize at the end of the week. So if you want to text in, we'll do a favourite phrase or favourite advice that your mammy's ever given you, and we'll put that in the hat then for the prize on Friday. All courtesy of Mulligan's Pharmacy, and you can shop online at Mulligan's Pharmacy. Keane O'Flaherty, good morning.
Good morning, Damien. How are you?
Good. What's the best advice Mammy ever gave you? Have you any lines that you can remember, no?
I can't. You stumped me. You stumped me. Perfect.
There you go. There you go. Some of them are brilliant that are coming in. Listen, it's lovely to talk to you. I know you're a busy bookle, and thanks so much for talking to us. You're a business person. You're one of the founders of the Feed the Heroes GoFundMe page. And it's been incredible. Hospitals, healthcare professionals and different places around the country are being helped with food by this campaign. Tell us, please, how it works, how it's operating.
So, yeah, Damien, we have a GoFundMe page run from feedtheheroes.com, and people who are obediently socially distancing at home but feel like they want to do something to help are donating in thousands to support spending money with kitchens, restaurants and deliveries that are still open and trying to keep the doors open, to send food into frontline workers who are working all hours and sacrificing across the country to keep us safe and to keep the people in hospital safe.
Yeah.
It's been mind-blowing and really blown away by the overwhelming generosity of people.
There's two things in here. One is the practical thing, because a lot of the people that are working these extra shifts, these long hours, they're tired, they don't get time to get out to do a bit of shopping, and that food can be very, very important. And there's a second thing. There's this solidarity. There's this sense of people working on the front line knowing that there's people out there doing this for them. That is just so important, isn't it?
It's incredible, and you're absolutely right. I mean, we've had already immense stories of self-sacrifice from across the country. People who work in the health sector already dedicate and sacrifice. And a couple of weeks ago, they were asked to step up and double down that effort. And without a question, they all, to a man and woman, have done that. So for us, it's the least we could do to make sure that where there's gaps from them being starving, not able to get to the shops, or just generally, you know, can we get a bit of a morale boost? We're able to give them something and help to just keep them in our thoughts and let them know that people are grateful. It's been phenomenal to see that feedback. It's been really unreal.
Like, I know, for example, doctors and nurses in the hospital here in Waterford, they've refused to go home on certain shifts because they just want to keep, they just this sense of their vocation being tested to the limit, and this idea that you'll keep going for the extra hour, you'll just keep going because you want to make sure everything is right. Then you have the issue, obviously, like the hospital's taking in food. They just have to be careful, I suppose, in terms of the sources. So it's very, very good to go through the campaign trust like yourselves, isn't that it?
Yeah, look, we started very, it's a very start thought. I thought we might raise enough to send a few pizzas to people to make it, you know, make their day, and that'd be kind of it. Tuesday, we'd be back to, I suppose, sitting at home. But now we are in operation. We're here for 10 weeks, 15 weeks, however long this emergency lasts. We're working with kitchens on a basis who know how to provide clean, health-safe food, are familiar with dropping to these organisations, as well as deliveries and takeaways, who are able to plug some of the gaps across the other parts of the sector, the public health, the testers, the ambulance drivers. And we're able to work with hospitals. We've gotten huge support in hospitals, providing areas and locations for drops so that staff know it's there and are able to avail themselves of nutritious meals, well prepared, that will keep them going. And if they need to take them home to reheat, fine as well. You know, the whole thing is supposed to be a marathon, not a sprint. We're only getting going by the looks of it. And we're open to absolutely everybody in the sector to let us know how best we can fill the gap and how best we can support them. Naturally, safety is paramount. Yes. And hospitals are right to want to do it the right way, and so are we. Anyone can directly contact us through the website if they're from a hospital and tell us how best to work with them to keep this going.
Very important, Keane. It's everybody working in the HSE. It's the doctors, the nurses, the porters, the cleaners, the admin staff. Yeah. Like going in doing admin work is as important in these times of crisis. It's everybody there. And we have to make sure that we include all those people in that, putting in the extra hours. Isn't that it?
Absolutely right. And it's recognising that everyone who's doing that is taking on an untold risk, and they have family and friends thinking about them at home constantly. So to know that at the very least there's somebody dropping something in to say, look, we're at home and we know we're doing our bit, but you're doing yours and we appreciate it. Mm. Look, it's a small token of the gratitude as a nation we clearly feel towards the people who are making these sacrifices.
And people can get in touch. Feed the Heroes on Facebook. Keane, thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
I just want to say a big shout out to Waterford. They were the first to step up and first to take a delivery. So thanks very much to Loco. If you don't mind me giving them a shout out, they're fantastic.
They are brilliant, and Loco is fabulous what they've done regarding this. Listen, Keane, keep up the great work and mind yourself.
Thanks,
okay?
And you too.
Take it easy. Thank you. Damien, yes, all hospital staff, every hospital staff, anybody working, not just in hospital, in other care centres, people working in nursing homes, people working in all different healthcare facilities, putting in extra hours to ensure patient safety. The Communication Workers Union on PUS staff donated treats and water to the staff at UHW as a token of our gratitude to what the frontline staff are going through from all our members. There's some beautiful messages coming in, folks. Really, really positive messages. It is really, really positive, and it's very, very important that we all stay positive in this difficult time. As you heard, people are worried and naturally worried, but you just take every day as it comes. Just get up in the morning and edge forward every day. And if you feel stressed, talk about it with your friends, with your family. Make a phone call to somebody if you want. If you feel under pressure, get out of the house. If you need to get out of the house, go for a walk on your own. Very important that nobody blows a fuse on this. Now, stay with us. I'm going to be taking more of your texts and queries in a second with David Cullinanae regarding social welfare and other matters and how to get in touch with people. Very important. The Citizens Information Bureau is always open to calls and emails, but don't drop in, worth mentioning. And the Citizens Information contact number is 0761 076 580. That's 0761 076 580. A lot of texts and calls coming in. Somebody's texted in, they work in a care facility, and they're concerned because a person came back from work from Spain and came back to work last week. Should they be concerned? Well, you're supposed to be self-isolating. If you come back from Spain, you have to self-isolate for 2 weeks. It's as simple as that. And if you have any concerns as a fellow worker, talk to management. Just be open and honest about it. It's not one of these things that people have to shy away from. Just talk nice and calmly about it and let management talk to the person itself. That's the way it's supposed to be. David Cullinanae, good morning.
Good morning, Damien. How are you?
I'm good, thanks. I'm good. How are you keeping?
Not too bad, Damien. I'm unfortunately one of the few people here in Leinster House today. We're on a slim down Dail, as you know, so there's only one third of the Dail that will sit, and we're dealing with the emergency legislation which will be before us today, and we have a number of amendments down where we're looking for additional supports for people. So we're just here today to get ready for that.
Yeah,
sitting at 2 o'clock.
We're talking all week, and we will be talking about all the issues that people have and answering people's questions in a calm, collected manner, and also then showing the positivity that's out there. What's your general feeling, David Cullinanae, in terms of how things are and how people have responded to this? Because effectively, we're only really a week into this. We did our first, I suppose you could call it, COVID-themed programme on Wednesday of last week. So we're only kind of 8 days really into where people have started to appreciate the gravity of the situation, do you think?
Absolutely, and it's unprecedented in many ways. So I think people are finally realising that this is on a scale that we haven't seen before, and it's not going to be with us for the next week or two. It's going to be for a couple of months, and no one knows when we will come out the other end of this. It looks like this will peak in about 10 to 12 weeks' time. All we can hope for is that the additional supports which are being put in place, and then the actions of individuals, which the vast majority of people are adhering to, will make an impact in slowing down the virus. And while that happens, that the supports that people need, because it's unprecedented in terms of the numbers of people who are losing their jobs. I mean, you see it in retail, in restaurants, in bars, but there's many other areas as well where people are losing their jobs, albeit on a temporary basis, but it's a huge trauma for those people. And what we need to do is make sure that all of the income supports and issues like paying rent and mortgages and so on are all dealt with very quickly. These are real life concerns that people have. And there is also concerns as well, Damien, that there are people who work in factories, people who work in call centres, people who work in settings where you have huge numbers of people who congregate, and they're concerned about when they go to work, are they contracting the virus and bringing that back to people that they live with and their family members and so on. So there's still uncertainty.
There is, and we've been getting a lot of those calls and texts into the programme, and my advice has been to tell people to talk to management, try and put in place as much systems as possible, and management are working as best they can because they're in this together with the people. It's not a case of management versus unions or management versus the workers or anything like that. This is a case where we're all in this together, because this virus, as we know, it doesn't respect boundaries, it doesn't respect barriers, it doesn't respect nationalities, or it doesn't respect management grades.
Absolutely. And I spoke to probably over 24 owners of businesses, and these are people who employ over 100 people over the course of the last few days. I've been inundated with people who work in call centres and factories and those type of settings where you have, we'll say, over 100 people or more who work in these settings. There are concerns, it has to be said. Most of the management have been very cooperative. There are some companies where there's no sick pay entitlements, for example, so people who don't come to work because they're concerned about what would happen if they do, they're being told to take holiday pay or unpaid leave. I think greater certainty has to be given to those workers, because that's an unfair situation for them to find themselves in. So what I'm trying to do, Damien, is act as a bridge, I suppose, between some of those workers and companies where there isn't the trade union and they don't have that solidarity and support. The vast majority of people I've spoken to and employers are in this with everybody else. They're doing their best. If you look at lots of businesses in Waterford in the entertainment sector, they were one of the first to move on this and close their businesses very, very quickly. So I think there is a real sense of solidarity that needs to be extended right across the board. There are people who are concerned about paying their rents, for example. There is nothing in the current bill which is before us today that deals with rents. We have a number of amendments down on that.
And I was just going to mention, that because having you on, as just I had Marco Cathasaigh on, there's no party politics in this. Number of people texted in this morning about the banks to giving the 3 month mortgage breaks, this new legislation that's coming in, and asking about the residential tenants board and what's going to happen with landlords. Now, Minister Donoghue has said that any landlord who receives such flexibility should not be entitled to evict tenants. It's not acceptable. We're putting in greater flexibility, he says. But there's nothing, as far as you say, as far as you can see, written down there at present regarding this matter, is there?
No, and I think, you know, obviously everybody is in this together, Damien, and nobody should be playing politics with what's happening here. We're working very closely with the government. We're working very closely with government ministers. We're looking for access to civil servants ourselves as best we can to feed back all of the queries and also the ideas that we have. So nobody has all the answers here, not the government or the opposition. We have to collectively pool all of the ideas that we have. A number of things that we're calling for and a number of amendments that we have in the bill are essentially around those type of things, where there's a prohibition on evictions for a couple of months. And that means that people won't have a fear of being evicted from their home if they can't pay their rent. Obviously, then we have an amendment in as well that will give the minister the power to put in place practical income supports for people who can't pay their rent. We're not being prescriptive in terms of what that should be. We're just giving the minister the power to do it so that all of those ideas can be looked at and then the best solution put in place as quickly as possible. But at least the minister would have the power to do it. The same for disconnections in relation to energy, broadband and telephone. I was in contact with all of the telecommunications providers and also the energy providers as a spokesperson for Sinn Féin in this area. Electric Ireland and Bord Gáis Energy have both come back to say that they will cease all disconnections for non-payment for a period of a number of months. I think that's to be welcomed, but yeah, it needs to be an industry-wide response. And essentially, if you think about it, what we need to do is to make sure that people have proper income supports. So we want the new pandemic unemployment allowance, which has been made available, and job seekers allowance, which people may have to go on to in time, to be increased in line with the illness benefit, so people don't have to worry about their income as best we can. Obviously, they won't have the same level of wages that they had, but they have enough income support to pay basic bills and to buy food. And then they don't have to worry about mortgages and rent and utility bills for a period of a few months.
Yeah, and you know, Dave, a texter in, at present, the way the new rules and laws are being constituted, David, is your mortgage recalculated after the break at a higher rate? Because it's not abiding to the original terms,
well,
do you know?
All of those issues, Damien, in terms of mortgages and rents and utility bills, what we have said to the government is that, listen, the best thing we can do at the moment is to make sure that there is a prohibition on people losing their homes, so there's no repossessions. The banks have come out and agreed to that. So, again, there has been an industry-wide response of 3 months' holiday on mortgages. The same needs to happen in relation to disconnections for energy and broadband and telephone. The same needs to happen with rents.
Okay.
Then over the next couple of weeks, we can figure out how we're going to give support to people, because what we don't want is at the other end of this, in a couple of months' time, people are stuck with additional mortgage payments and they have arrears in relation to rents or arrears in relation to bills. And there's going to be different solutions and different ideas in terms of how we do all of that.
Yeah.
But I think the very first thing we have to do is make sure that people know that they have those supports, that they're not going to be evicted, they're not going to be disconnected, and they're not, you know, they don't have to pay their rent for a couple of months, whatever that time period might be.
David, listen.
And then we need to collectively work out how we deal with it. So listen, I just want to say to yourself, Damien, yep, and to your listeners, to take care. It's a very difficult time. I'm sure we'll keep in touch over the next few weeks, and people should look after their families and their loved ones now at this tough time.
Fair play to you. Listen, David, thanks very much. Appreciate
it.
Thank you very much.
Take care.
Song of Fall. A lot of people texting in. I may not get to all the texts. As I say, we're receiving a phenomenal amount of texts and questions, and every day, a lot of people obviously at home, a lot of people listening to the radio. We appreciate you listening to this radio station. We appreciate if you're going to turn off at certain stages, if you've had too much, that's absolutely fine. We appreciate people are coming to this from different levels, and there's so much positivity out there, and we're going to reflect that as much as possible. For example, Claire from our digital media team has asked if anybody has nice pictures from home or whatever, send them into the WLR Instagram page. Text us in to 083 or WhatsApp 083 333 975. Give permission if we can put them up on the WLR Instagram page, and we'll start posting positive pictures, and we'll do a lots of positivity on this. Now, welcome back to the programme. Keep in touch, keep your texts and comments coming in. Well done, Damien, great to hear some lovely music on the radio. Keep us all upbeat during this tough time. Damien, your favourite Eurovision is Hold Me Now by Johnny Logan. Other people texting in different questions. Now, as part of their response to the crisis, the Catholic Diocese of Waterford and Lismore, Bishop Alphonsus is setting up a Dail a Prayer service. And two nuns with the Sisters of Mary Morning Star will be operating the phone lines if people want to ring in to pray. I think we've got Sister Anastasius. Is that it on the phone?
Yeah, here I am.
Thank you very much for joining us. You're originally from the Netherlands and you're based in Waterford now, and you are with Sister Aylit Marie, who is French, and you're both based in Waterford. Tell me about this service, please, Sister.
So maybe you'd just like to introduce ourselves?
Yes, please
do. We are a community of contemplative sisters, and our life is dedicated to prayer, fraternal charity, and search for truth. Bit similar to all contemplative orders, But without cloister, in order to be a visible presence of hope in today's world. And we started a foundation here in Waterford about 1 year ago. Bishop Fonsi invited us to be a presence of prayer here in the Diocese of Waterford and Lismore. And so we are very happy. We are today six sisters here in the city of Waterford. And we are very happy and grateful to be here in Ireland, in the Friary, thanks to the generosity and kindness of the Franciscans.
Okay, you're based in the Friary. Very good. And Bishop Alphonsus Cullinan was on to me last week and he was talking about setting up this Dail a Prayer service. So how is it going to operate, please?
Yes, so Dail a Prayer is an initiative for people to entrust their intentions, especially in those days of trials in the world. And so the purpose is to call, to say very simply your prayer intention. We will write them down and we will keep them in our daily prayer, adoration, Mass and Rosary, and also through the offering of our whole life to Jesus. Also, other religious houses of the diocese will join in praying for these intentions.
Okay. And how is it going to operate? In other words, if somebody... What's the phone number, by the way, if people want to ring in?
So, the phone number is 085-7611-822.
Okay, so that's 085-7611-822. And how often during the day will this phone line be operational?
Okay, people can call each day from 2 p.m. to 3 p.m. and a sister will answer the phone and be there for you and receive your prayer intention.
Okay, so from 2 to 3 o'clock every day. So if somebody wants to ring up, and if the phone line is engaged, will there be more, like, for example, there could be dozens of people ringing at a particular time. The phone may be engaged. Are there a couple of different lines, or what is the situation?
There's only one line, but you have to try again.
And yes. And, for example, somebody might want to ring you to have a chat, to have a talk, to maybe talk about things. You don't want somebody, I suppose, to be on the line for too long, because if you're only there for an hour, you don't want one person being on for 20 minutes. It's just literally for somebody to ring up and to express what they want to say. Is that it?
That's right. But the people are most welcome as well to come and pass by here in the Friary if they want a little bit more time to speak and to entrust their intention. That could be another option.
Yes.
For the phone, it's true. It can't be very long because a lot of people would like to call and entrust their prayers.
And I presume as well that if they do call to the Friary, that you are adhering to social distancing, that there is this
yeah.
You have to be very careful, don't you?
Yeah, we have, of course.
And your sister Elite Marie is there as well with you, I know. And if you find that this service is going to be quite big, if you find there's going to be a lot of people looking to avail of the service, would you look at extending it?
We'll see how it works. And we'll see if God wants us to make it bigger or not. But for now, we'll begin just with an hour and we'll see how it works, maybe.
And as you say, you will be receiving the prayers or the requests of prayers from a member of the public who phones up, and then you will be passing that prayer on, or how does one explain it?
Exactly. So I think we'll write it down, and then, of course, we will. Each sister can see it. We have an intention board in the convent, and so each sister can see it, pray for it, and then we'll send it to other communities so that everyone can pray for these intentions.
Okay, very good. Well, the very best of luck with it, sisters. And the number is 085-7611-822. That's 085-7611-822. And that's between 2 and 3 o'clock. Every afternoon, are you going to do it 7 days a week or just at the minute 5 days a week?
7 days a week, we will be there to answer the phone.
Okay. And to pray for the intentions. Well, I know a lot of the listeners may think it's a good idea because they haven't been able to get the Mass. And thank you very much, sisters, for joining us this morning. That's Sister Anastasis, originally from the Netherlands, Sister Elite Marie. And the very best of luck to you.
Okay, thank you so much. Thank you, Damien.
Thank you very much. Au revoir. Take care and mind yourselves. Thanks very much, sisters. That's Sisters of the Mary Morning Star with the new Dial a Prayer service that has been set up. What do you think of that? Let us know. 083-333-975. Do the sisters have a Facebook page where they can be contacted? As far as I know, you can contact them through the Catholic Diocese of Lismore and Waterford. Damien, what about old age pension collections? My daughter usually collects mine, but she can't. I'm 68. I don't want to go out, but I don't want to live with no pension. Contact the social welfare offices. Contact the citizen information number 0761. OK, write this down. 0761-076-580. That's 0761-076-570. Phone number into Audrey to 0518461123. A woman called in to say she knows someone who got tested on Monday but still hasn't got results. Does that mean the figures they're giving out are 4 days behind? There is a lagging in the figures that are being given out. It doesn't necessarily mean they're 4 days behind, but there is a lagging in the figures. Another person texted in. Damien, can you please highlight the fact that I rang my GP 5 days ago because my son and I have a number of COVID-19 symptoms. I travelled home from a high-risk area with confirmed cases, which I didn't realise at the time. We are in total lockdown and indeed limbo. I still haven't received any contact from the HSE regarding testing. Good practice starts with testing, so they say. So can you please shed some light on this? And this person, this is a gentleman, I know his name. He doesn't want me to read out his name. The GP said yesterday that the HSE should get back to you. I would contact the GP again and again and again if you have to, if you're in that situation and you're very worried. Again, GPs are inundated with calls, but in that particular case, my friend, yourself and your son need to be tested, it sounds like. So you need basically to have contacted the GP and stress the importance of this. Damien, any place in town with face masks for sale? I don't know of any place in particular. We're going to be talking to a man after the news at 11 about face masks. We're continuing our final push for our faith-led competition. Text us in advice from your mammy. And this is part of Mulligan's Pharmacy. Mulligan's gift card, mulliganspharmacy.com. Any advice from your mammy? 083-333-975. Win a lovely afternoon tea and spa treatment for yourself and your mum in Faith Lake House Hotel, probably for later in the year, we would say. And we're going to have our Gimme a Break competition in the second part of the show. And also our Eurovision, our little Eurovision. What do you think of this one? And now this is definitely Get Up and Dance. Here we go. Let's see you moving around the kitchen or wherever you're dancing, or if you're driving, turn up the radio.